Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. Today, we have a very exciting program, inviting two expertise, well-known professors on Okinawan military base issue. And they are going to give us a solution as they published the book called Okinawa Solution. So literally, they are trying to solve the this very complicated and important question. As a matter of fact, it became a big news today, this morning, in the Japanese papers, television and news, that the government side has gone to the High Court in Fukuoka in order to continue their program to remove Marine Air Station from Utenma to Henoko. And this is, in fact, unprecedented case. Unprecedented, not just for Okinawa, but all over our political history, that the prefecture and the government, central government, are going to court and are going to confrontation. And so in that sense, also, this is an important. We have two well-known professors. And on my immediate right is Professor Mike Mochizuki, who has been an expert, who has been a professor at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. He earned his PhD from Harvard University and has been a co-director at the Center of the Asia-Pacific Policy at RAND in California, and later on became director of the Sigler Center for Asian Studies at the George Washington University. We have on my far right, Professor Akikazu Hashimoto, who is a project professor at the J.F. Oberlin University in Tokyo. He got his PhD from Keio University and later served as a visiting scholar at the University of Southern California. He's an expert on the unaffiliated borders for understanding electoral politics in Japan. And so let us give a warm welcome to our two guests. Thank you. And we'll first start from Professor Mochizuki and next to Professor Hashimoto. And then afterwards, we'll throw the floor to the Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Murakami, for that kind introduction. And I want to also thank the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan for putting this event on for us. I've spoken a couple of times before at the FCCJ, and I'm glad to be back. Professor Hashimoto and I have been working on the U.S. military base issue in Okinawa for now, I can't believe, over 20 years. I was at the Brookings Institution when the terrible rape incident took place in the fall of 1995. And that prompted me to look seriously at our military presence on Okinawa. And immediately I saw that this base issue was the Achilles heel of the U.S.-Japan alliance. And so I worked very closely with a dear friend and colleague, Dr. Michael O'Hanlon, who's one of America's foremost experts on U.S. Military strategy, force structure, and budgeting, to take a serious look at the functions that our military presence in Japan serves for Asian security, and especially the role of the Marine Corps. And since then, we've been writing numerous articles and books on this issue. But we also have been getting terrific cooperation from Professor Hashimoto. He, as you know, is a noted specialist on Japanese politics, especially the issue of public opinion and public will. But I also found out in 1995 that he has extensive contacts and friends in Okinawa, and he played a pivotal role in introducing Michael O'Hanlon and me to some of the leaders in Okinawa, and that's how we were able to get a better grasp of the situation in Okinawa. Now, as Mr. Murakami indicated, we offer in this book entitled The Okinawa Solution a concrete plan to deal with the so-called FTEMA-based issue. And we argue that it is unnecessary to go and build the Henoco landfill runway. And we have handed out on a one-sheet paper. I mean, you've been receiving a number of handouts, so it may be hard to know which one is the key one, but it's called Compromise Proposal to Resolve the FTEMA Base Issue. And it gives really a six-point plan to deal with the FTEMA issue without building the landfill facility. So what I want to do today in the brief amount of time that's initially allocated to me is to go over what I think are kind of five, I don't, for lack of a better term, the conventional wisdom about the FTEMA base issue. And it's become so conventional that I think in many ways it has become a myth. These are myths that seem to inform much of the public discourse today, especially on the main islands of Japan, but also in Washington, D.C., about the Okinawa base issue. And I think, you know, despite the excellent work that all of you do, in many of the articles, the assumption is of the articles that you write have these conventional wisdoms or myths. Myth number one, that there is only a choice between building the landfill facility at Henoco or keeping FTEMA open as it is forever, for the foreseeable future. I mean, that is the way that the Japanese government characterizes the issue, and they argue that they care about reducing the burden on Okinawans, and therefore, if you are in favor of reducing the burden on Okinawans, you've got to build this Henoco landfill facility. So it's the choice between building the Henoco landfill facility on the one hand, or keeping FTEMA open as it is. And we argue in this book that that is definitely a myth. Of course, in 2006, the landfill plan was agreed to by the U.S. and Japanese governments, but there have been a number of other plans that have been discussed. Although they claim that they were seriously considered, I think for a variety of reasons, whether it's responding to local interests or responding to the perspectives of the U.S. Marine Corps, they settled on the 2006 plan. But we feel that that plan is not the only way to resolve the FTEMA issue, and our compromise proposal gives a very concrete and realistic way of solving this. Myth number two, and this is something that I heard numerous times when I engaged U.S. policymakers since 1995, is that it is in trying to think about an alternative to FTEMA, the fundamental thing that is necessary is to keep the U.S. Marine Corps aircraft close to the ground forces. So since you have such a large contingent of U.S. Marine Corps ground forces, you needed to have some kind of air facility that is close by for the Marine aircraft. Again, this is a myth. I mean, if you look at exactly the kinds of day-to-day operations that the helicopters have been playing at FTEMA and now the Ospreys, you know, many of the training exercises do not involve having the ground forces on them. And many of the exercises involve touch and go, kind of landing and takeoff exercises. And this causes a great deal of disturbance to the local community around of Themba. Even former Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel has argued that now over 50% of the U.S. Marine Corps training involving Ospreys are located outside of Okinawa. The other thing which makes this notion of having to have the aircraft and the ground units close by, making that into a myth, is that you know, although many Okinawans and some Japanese oppose the Ospreys, I feel that this is a major upgrade in U.S. Marine transport capabilities. So now the Ospreys can be located on the main islands of Japan, and when there is a need to go to Okinawa to pick up ground units that are deployed on the island of the main island of Okinawa, they could fly quite quickly to Okinawa, pick up the ground units, and go on their training missions. Okay, so that's the second myth. The third myth, and we hear this often from the Japanese government, that the building of this air facility at Henoko is necessary for deterrence. The international environment, the regional environment, is becoming increasingly uncertain, if not threatening, with the North Korean nuclear weapons program, with the Chinese maritime assertiveness and the problems with the Senkaku Islands, and also the continuing uncertainties about the Taiwan question. And therefore, the Henoko facility needs to be built. And I think this is really a misuse of a very complicated theory about deterrence. And I could go on and on about deterrence theory, but the nutshell here is that in terms of U.S. extended deterrence, the most important capabilities, in addition to the U.S. strategic nuclear capability, are the U.S. 7th Fleet and the U.S. air capability, and the most important base on Okinawa is Kadena Air Force Base. Now, it's great to have the Marines here in Japan to deal with humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. It was clear that they played a very important role after the earthquake, tsunami, and Fukushima disaster. But in terms of deterring conflict, the role of the Marine Corps is negligible. So if you think about a Korean contingency, many defense planners would point to the map and say, Okinawa is in a strategically important location to deal with Korea. Well, if you go back to Korean history and the Korean War, the history of the Korean War, it was not from Okinawa that the U.S. Marine Corps established a staging area to launch a counteroffensive on the Korean Peninsula. It was from Kyushu. It's much better to have the Marines be on standby for a Korean contingency on one of the main islands than in Okinawa. And Michael O'Hanlon and I have written that the most efficient way is to have pre-positioned Marine equipment in Japan, and then fresh troops could be flown in from the continent of the United States to marry up with this equipment to be part of a Korean military contingency. Well, what about the Senkakus, one might say? Well, at the end of the day, to prevent the Chinese from seizing the Senkaku Islands, and I personally feel that there is very little value on the Chinese part to seizing the Senkaku Islands, but if just for a moment you think that that is the Chinese plan, then the best way to buttress deterrence is for the for the Japanese to develop their own capabilities to prevent China from launching an attack and win a cheap victory. The major role that the United States can play is in terms of preventing an escalation of this relatively modest gray area conflict from going into the high intensity zone, and the United States can do that through its air and sea naval capabilities. Now, it's quite possible that the Marine Corps could play a signaling role in terms of preventing the Chinese from being reckless vis-a-vis the Senkakus. And our solution to this is, well, have a kind of a step-by-step signaling possibility. Let's say you had the Marine Corps Ospreys permanently deployed somewhere on Kyushu. During a time of tensions, the Osprey can fly to our proposal of a heliport inside Camp Schwab, pick up the ground units, and then maybe go to one of the islands that's closer to the Senkakus. And then that would give the Chinese even more pause about seizing the Senkakus. So we think that the argument that the Henoko runway is necessary for deterrence is completely misguided. The fourth myth or conventional wisdom is that given that this plan was decided in 2006, revising this plan would be bad for the U.S.-Japan alliance. And people invoked 2009 when Prime Minister Prime Minister Hatoyama called for a revision of the plan, and clearly the United States resisted. But here, the context of the resistance is very important, because in large part due to the lack of competence on the part of the DPJ government, there was a misinterpretation in Washington, D.C., that the DPJ government under Prime Minister Hatoyama was weakening the U.S.-Japan alliance, moving away from the United States towards China, and even promoting an East Asian community that seemed to exclude the United States. Now, I've interviewed former Prime Minister Hatoyama a couple of times, and he absolutely denies that his notion of an East Asian community was designed to exclude the United States. But nevertheless, that was the impression in Washington, D.C. And because of that, even those in Washington that might have been sympathetic to rethinking the 2006 plan would not be willing to do so, because they thought giving in to the Hatoyama government would somehow weaken the U.S.-Japan alliance. Now, if you go to today, we're in a completely different situation. I've argued since 1995 that the best way to resolve the Okinawa issue is to strengthen the U.S.-Japan alliance and then reduce the Marine presence in Okinawa. And I think we are now pretty much at that state. I mean, I've talked about a new strategic bargain between Tokyo and Washington. And so now that Prime Minister Abe has been able to pass the so-called security legislation package, plus a seal and begin to implement the new U.S.-Japan defense cooperation guidelines, I think it is now possible to revise the 2006 realignment plan without weakening the U.S.-Japan alliance. And although the U.S. government officials do not openly talk about this, there are a number of former officials in very high positions who have now come out publicly and have talked about more flexibility, including former ambassador to Japan, Michael Armacost, former Assistant Secretary of Defense, Joseph Nye, even former Deputy Secretary of State, Rich Armitage, in an interview, said that if the Japanese come up with an alternative plan, then America should be willing to listen. And then the fifth conventional wisdom, and this is something that one increasingly hears is that at the end of the day, the Okinawan people will want the return of Denma, and therefore they will acquiesce to the Henoko plan. And some even say that the so-called All Okinawa Movement, which is the movement that has supported the election of Governor Onaga, has pretty much reached its peak. And then as the construction moves forward, then that movement will begin to die down. First of all, you know, I just spent 10 days in Okinawa talking to a lot of people, and it's clear to me that even if the government, central government, wins the legal battle, there are all sorts of administrative tools that the local governments, especially the mayor of Nago City, can use to delay this project. And so when a couple of weeks ago there were all these news clips about the restart of the construction of the Henoko facility, if you look carefully at the film clips, you know, they were just moving around some of the waste on the land, and it will take quite some time before they can really move forward with the actual landfill project. But the other thing is that the public discourse in Okinawa has changed fundamentally, and Professor Hashimoto has been following this very carefully since 1995. And so my concern is that the more the Japanese government pushes on the current Henoko plan, the more the resistance will get stronger. And eventually, it may get so strong and it might become so broad that it will make things difficult for us to maintain other important facilities on Okinawa. So, you know, I think it's important to watch very carefully the politics of Okinawa over the next several months. The first indicator, I think, will be the mayor's election in Ginowan City. Mr. Sakima is the incumbent, and he seems to show more flexibility towards the government's Henoko plan. But there is a opposition candidate that is supported by Governor Onaga, and he could defeat Mr. Sakima. And this would be a major setback for the Japanese government, because it's trying to make the case that the Henoko plan is necessary to close down Futenma, and that the residents around Futenma and Ginowan City then must favor the Henoko plan. And then after that, you have the prefectural assembly elections and then the House of Councilors election. So sometime during the summer, I think we will be able to take better stock at whether the government's view that the anti-Henoko base movement has begun to peak, or whether, you know, our view that as the Japanese government uses strong arm tactics, that this movement will get stronger. So these are the five conventional wisdoms or myths that we challenge in the book. I don't need to go through all the 6 points of this proposal, but we basically couch this as a compromise plan. We are reviving one of the options that was considered in spring 1996 in the interim SOCO report, the Special Action Committee on Okinawa. There were three alternatives that were considered at the time. One was the integration of the Futenma functions into Kadena. The other was a sea-based facility. And third was a heliport inside Camp Schwab. At the end of the day, the U.S. and Japanese governments opted for a sea-based facility, which then got discarded in 2006. What we are saying is that why not revive the spring 2006 option of the heliport and take advantage of the major changes that are now going in terms of a U.S. Marine Corps organization and force structure and force posture, moving away from a garrison type deployment in the Asia Pacific to a more expeditionary type of operations, and take advantage also of the technological advances in transport with the Osprey. So we see this proposal not only as a win for the U.S.-Japan alliance, but also a win for Okinawa. And by implementing this, I think we will finally have a long-term solution to the base problem in Okinawa. So now I want to turn the floor over to Professor Hashimoto if he wants to add anything. Thank you very much.
Hello, we are welcome to here, so thank you so much. And Mr. Nakaima, the former governor, and Hashimoto, and Mike Mochizuki, and the former vice governor, Kurayoshi Takara, has started the Okinawa Christian Project in 23rd. But now, Mike Mochizuki and Hashimoto now started again as a new project named not Okinawa Question, but Okinawa Solution. This is the new book. So today's we showed a compromise proposal to resolve the Futenma base issue. And that Mr. Mochizuki has already now mentioned. I have two-way approaches on today's issue for myself. One is from viewpoint of current public opinion in Okinawa, and another is from the viewpoint of realistic and concrete approach. So the first, preface. I tell you preface to today's tema. As you know, the Futenma relocation issue has been in the deadlock. Governor Onaga in Okinawa Prefecture has been continued to oppose the construction of a new airfield base in Henoko District, replacing the Futenma Marine Corps Air Station, while Abe Cabinet has asserted that it is a sole realistic option to relocate to Henoko District in order to avoid the most dangerous situation in Futenma Airfield. But U.S. Congress has lately deleted the expression of the phrase, the only viable solution, you know. On the other hand, Onaga has been taking his disobedient stance, providing no alternative plans whatsoever. He has also strongly asserted that the construction of the newly runway base within Okinawa Prefecture is definitely unnecessary. How long do you suppose this confrontational situation between central government and Okinawa Prefecture are going to continue? It said that it would be more than 10 years to construct completely Henoko base. If Futenma would continue operating until the completion of the construction in Henoko Bay, we are afraid, meanwhile, the real dangerous situation could happen. The assertion that the construction of a new Henoko base is absolutely necessary in order to avoid the Futenma dangerous situation would paradoxically bring Futenma dangerous situation in 10 years. So as Professor Mochizuki said now, pushing the current Henoko plan would paradoxically lead to the continued use of Futenma because of the numerous obstacles to constructing the V-shaped landfill runway. But the continued use of Futenma Air Station should not be allowed because of the dangers it poses to the local community near the base. Even though the Japanese government has stated that constructing the Henoko air facility will continue, opposition in Okinawa will persist and could grow much stronger. It is a fallacy to think that Okinawa will eventually acquiesce to the Henoko facility as construction proceeds. A large majority of Okinawans now feel that the Japanese government policy to build a new base on Okinawa reflects discrimination against Okinawans and a lack of understanding to the unfair burden that Okinawa has carried to host the U.S. military presence, which has contributed to the security of all of Japan. Therefore, the more the central government Stanbori tried to push ahead with the construction of the military base, the more Okinawa opposition will intensify and continue to the last. Then what will happen? We are very concerned about the happening of a terrible disaster. The Ginoman City Memorial election in January 2016, next year, will be a good indicator of how Okinawan's views are shifting. If the resident living near Futenma elects Mr. Keiichiro Shimura candidate, who opposes the Henoko base, then the voters will be rejecting the notions that the choice is between building the Henoko landfill base and allowing the Futenma to remain open for the foreseeable future. I dare to say again, this is nothing but a paradox. So this rigid way of thinking on Japan's part, just like moving Futenma to site A or B, or moving Futenma to a new site within Okinawa, within or outside Okinawa, has caused this main paradox. In short, they tend to view the issue primarily as a real estate issue. Don't you think so? Let's abandon on the rigid way of thinking and consider the Okinawa replacement plan from the viewpoint of the dynamic and integrated defense force concept that the Japanese Ministry of Defense in the National Defense Program guidelines for fiscal year 2011 and 2014. We are very concerned about the happening of the disastrous incident. As you have already understood, our alternative plan is neither to construct a V-shaped runway or on reclaimed land at Henoko in Oda Bay, nor to continue the use of Futenma Marine Corps Air Station, and needless to say, nor total withdrawal to outside Okinawa and also outside Japan. The more pushing the current Henoko plan stumbly, the stronger total removal movement, including Kadena Air Base, will be. That's a very pivotal. You know, the Kadena Airport is a pivotal air base for U.S.-Japan alliance. Our alternative plan is a jointly plan revised ongoing Abe administration plan. And next phrase, what should be implemented now is to take a visible step forward on presentation, prescription. Former Governor Hirokazu Nakajima offered Prime Minister Shinzo Abe in December 2013, shortly before giving the approval for the land reclamation, the discontinuance of the operation of Futenma Air Station within 5 years as a condition to accept the relocation of Futenma to Henoko. What can be said of 2015 is that something in the near term, namely in the next 5 years from now, should be the top priority issue for which the government will make every earnest effort, Prime Minister Abe said, rather than issue of 10 years afterwards. So what should be implemented now is to fill the perception of a gap between Uchinanchu and Yamatonchu. Uchinanchu, you know, Okinawan's people, and Yamatonchu is Japan mainland people. As I have already showed the 3 points. The first, discriminatory situation. Second, indifferent. Third, lack of understanding. It's important to prepare this prescription of resolution in a fashion that these 3 points become visible as soon as possible. To second, what should be implemented now is to promote the dispersed deployment Osprey also outside Okinawa. Third, what should be implemented now to deploy gradually rotary wing aircraft of FTEMA without the necessity of integrated operation outside Okinawa and Japan in rotational system. So concern this statement. So if you have any question, I will answer later. And finally, as I repeat Professor Mike Mochizuki's statement concerning the next phrase, I'll cut down and explain shortly. So, deployment with the integrated and mobile capability based on the rotational presence in the Asian Pacific region, Pendleton, USS, and Hawaii, Darwin, Australia, and Guam, Japan, mainland, and Okinawa. The skeleton as below. To promote to establish an operational U.S. Marine Corps presence in Guam. Second, to promote to locate MAGTAL, Marine Air Ground Task Force, you know, in Okinawa, Guam, and Hawaii, and also to establish a rotational presence in Australia. The 31 Marine Expedition Unit, so-called 31MEU. 31MEU's strength is its ability to respond to crisis as an integrated MAGTAF and could keep its home base in Okinawa at the forward presence. Last, a more effective and efficient alternative to the Henoko base would be to preposition Marine Corps combat equipment. This would enable rapid deployment of U.S. Marine Corps units from the U.S. continent. So after Okinawa question, so we, Mike Mochizuki and Hashimoto, started again as a new name as the Okinawa Solution. That's all. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Professors Mochizuki and Hashimoto. As I was listening to Professor Hashimoto's statement, when he said it's almost paradoxical to build a new air station base in a new place, and that Henoko will take 10 years, so that means leaving FTEMA for 10 years as it is. On the one side, the government is saying they can't leave it even one day longer because it's so damn dangerous. And what I just thought of is maybe the Japanese government was thinking that they would like to have their own base in the future since they cannot get Kadena out of the United States' hands. So that may be one of the reasons that they don't mind taking for 10 years. We'll see. I forgot to mention at the outset, please turn off your cell phone or put into a silent mode. And secondly, I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Yoshio Murakami. I'm an advisor to the International New York Times Asia edition in Japan and has been the Asahi Shimbun journalist for many, many years. Now we would move to the Q&A period, and I would like anyone who has questions to come to the microphone and identify your name and your affiliation, and we'll start from the working press.
Thank you very much. I Linda C. from Reuters. I'd like to sneak in two questions, actually. Well, the first is, as you mentioned, that the Japanese government in particular seems to think that the opposition in Okinawa will eventually fade away. People will give up and acquiesce. On what do you base your assessment of public opinion in Okinawa? I mean, there, you know, the government sort of implies that it's a lot of outside agitators and you know, lefties and old people. And secondly, where do you think, since it seems to me, an outsider, that this sounds quite reasonable, where is the main opposition to this proposal coming from, both on the US and the Japanese side? Thank you.
Okay, yeah, well, thank you very much, Linda. First, in terms of the opposition movement and why we think it's growing rather than peaking. Well, there are you know, two sets of data. You know, one is the variety of public opinion polls that have been taken by a number of media organizations, of course, many of them located in Okinawa, and some of them on the main islands, but some also taken by the Okinawa prefectural government. And over time, the percentage of Okinawans that are against the Henoko base has grown, and I think it's now around 80%. And so rather than it declining, you know, it has grown. And then also, I think Asahi has taken some polls on the main islands, and the main islands have also become much more empathetic towards the Okinawans, and they are now, I think, more favor rethinking the plan than going forward with it. So there's the public opinion polls. The other is in terms of the social movement. And I know I have heard that these are outside agitators, the kind of the remnants of the leftist movement from the main islands, and they've gone down as professionals to organize this. And you know, I've also heard that, well, the Chinese are behind this. So that's why I spent 10 days in Okinawa talking to many of the people who were involved in this movement. And I went on the Shimagurumi Kaigi bus from Naha to the Camp Schwab gate, not to observe, you know, not to participate in the protest, because I was there as really a more of a objective observer. And yes, there were many who are retired. And you know, if you think about it, the young people you know, are raising families and have to work, and so they're not going to spend the entire day to go out to Camp Schwab to protest. But talking to those that were on that bus, it was clear to me that they felt deeply about this issue, and they're educating themselves much more about this issue. It's almost, you know, I remember during the student movement anti-Vietnam War days that we would have teach-ins. Well, that's what they were having. They were having teach-ins and giving some very detailed programs, lectures about the legal process, about the administrative process. I took copious notes. But one other thing that I noticed is that the discourse has changed. They were beginning to talk about the Battle of Okinawa, and even before, during the Ryukyu Kingdom, and how the Japanese abducted the monarch and incorporated the Ryukyu Kingdom into Japan. I mean, they use the term Rachi, they use the term Hegel. You know, these are terms that are often used to talk about Japan-Korea relations. But the main thing was that they said that it couldn't be helped that all of these U.S. military bases got placed in Okinawa after the war because Japan lost the war and the U.S. Military built these bases using bulldozers and bayonets. But this will be the first new facility that will be built after democracy had been established in Okinawa. And if Okinawans allow this to happen, then it would be their responsibility. And therefore, they cannot let that happen. And the other thing they recognized was that after the post-war, after the war, during the early post-war period, the United States started to downsize much of its military presence on the main islands. Why? It wasn't for strategic reasons, but it was because they were concerned that there would be a growing anti-base, anti-security treaty movement on the main islands. And so Okinawa became the dumping ground for a lot of these bases. And so they're studying this history, so there's a consciousness raising. Now, of course, you know, there will be some business interests, especially construction firms, that will gain a lot from this project. But I think most Okinawans feel that they cannot let this happen. And so that's why, you know, I think that the movement is going to grow. But still, you know, I'm open to having my hypotheses kind of falsified. And so one indication will be what will happen in the Ginowa mayor's election and then the Okinawa prefectural assembly elections. And if the incumbent mayor loses in Ginowa City, then I think that's evidence, further evidence to support our thesis. Yes, the source of opposition. Part of it has to do with kind of inertia and kind of sunk bureaucratic investment. So when I go around explaining our plan, you know, that they all acknowledge that this makes great military sense. And so then when I ask, well, can you support it? It says, well, first, we've got to build the Henoko facility, and then maybe we can talk about this. Well, I said, well, there's no point in building the Henoko facility if you support the other. And it's that, well, the U.S. and the Japanese government agreed to this, and because we agreed to this, we have to implement this. And, you know, I mean, I've seen this kind of bureaucratic thinking in other areas, but it seems to me that at the end of the day, if you've got a policy that is producing results that you don't want to see, then it's better to not be stubborn and to think about this. But you know, I think the resistance on the Abe government side is that, you know, they have the negative example of Prime Minister Hatoyama, and you know, we've seen Prime Minister Abe. Once he decides to do something, you know, he wants to go ahead with it. And then on the U.S. side, I think the real difficulty is the politics of this, because this is a compromise plan, and there will be some in Okinawa that cannot embrace even a heliport on Camp Schwab. And therefore, it will take a coming together of both the Nakajima camps and the Onaga camps in Okinawa. And so I think it's not so much resistance, but it's a concern that even if a compromise plan is embraced, it might be difficult to implement. And I acknowledge that the politics are very complicated. But this notion that the Henoko plan can be built even in 10 years, I think, is wildly optimistic. It could take even longer than that, given the pushback that we'll see in Okinawa.
Siegfried Niedler, writing for the Austrian newspaper. Der Standard. You talked about a situation in 2009, a distrust of the America in the Hatoyama government. But can it not be said in the opposite? There is some underlying distrust in Japan about the American commitment. I think there was a lot of discussion about American withdrawn from the outside countries. A lot of candidates from the Republican Party talking about this. So would not be for the American government to give up the building of the Henoko base for the America, for the Japanese side, a sign we cannot trust really the United States. And my second question is not perhaps the whole base is in Okinawa in a dangerous position because China is too close with his missiles. It's not us, are not all bases in Okinawa a very easy target for the Chinese missiles. So what, how to handle this problem?
Thank you very much for those questions. Yes, you know, it's interesting that even when the United States announced that it wanted to move several thousand forces, Marine Corps units from Okinawa to Guam, there were quite a few Japanese specialists of security who were quite nervous about this, and they thought that this kind of departure signified a weakening of the U.S. Commitment. I'm one of those that think this Japanese concern about the U.S. Commitment is just overdrawn. Our commitment has been reinforced over and over again. You know, just because we change the force posture to make it much more efficient and effective. You know, I hear some Japanese pundits say, you know, I remember hearing one Japanese pundit say this in Washington, that if one Marine were reduced on Okinawa, that would weaken deterrence. And that kind of notion, you know, just seems to me so fallacious. And to some extent, it really reflects the underdeveloped state of security studies in Japan. Now, you know, I'm with the Japanese that sometimes the U.S. administration gets distracted. Sometimes the United States is fickle. The United States is a global power, and we worry about other parts of the world, you know, like we're doing now for very good reason. But the United States has been a Pacific power since the beginning of the 20th century. We will continue to be a Pacific power. We have keen economic and strategic interests. And so just because we change the Marine deployment, or because we don't build this modest landfill facility, somehow the U.S. commitment is going to weaken. I mean, that's just hard for me to imagine. And at the end of the day, it's bases like Kadena and the Seventh Fleet in Yokosuka. Now, the other point about the vulnerability of U.S. bases on Japan, you know, that is definitely true. Now, some might say, therefore, we should just close down all these facilities. Well, the possibility that China would launch a missile strike at these bases would really lead to a high-intensity conflict. So, and really a war between the United States and China. And so one has to imagine under what circumstances that might take place. It's not about Korea. China is pretty much a status quo power about Korea. It's only one scenario that I can imagine, and it's not the Senkakus. It's Taiwan. And so that the more that there is cross-strait dialogue and a move towards tension reduction and the sorts of diplomacy that we've seen recently of Ma Ying-jeou, then the possibility of a military conflict over Taiwan recedes. And so I think that's the number one priority. And if for some reason we can't prevent that war, and if we're just thinking about the worst case scenario, then the solution is not to leave Kadena, but to harden the Kadena facilities, because if you're not using weapons of mass destruction on those missiles, then I think it's possible to survive some attacks to make those facilities still operational. And then the other thing is to disperse those facilities. So don't put all of your eggs in the Kadena basket. And this is why we're building Guam as a second hub, and Misawa could be another area. And in fact, in a more detailed version of our plan, you know, I've argued that some of the fixed wing of the Marine aircraft could go to Kadena, but at the same time, you would have to then reduce some of the Air Force contingent in order to satisfy the local community around Kadena. And you could send them to Anderson Air Force Base in Guam, but also to Misawa Air Force Base. Yeah, I think I've answered the questions.
Isabel Reynolds from Bloomberg. I was wondering, I'm sorry I haven't had time to read all your paperwork, and perhaps it's actually in there.
We threw a lot of paper.
But I was wondering, how did they hit upon this idea of the landfill? I mean, my very vague memory of it was that to keep it offshore would reduce the burden of noise pollution on the island. I seem to remember that being mentioned. But how did they come to this plan as the best idea and reject the one that you're now suggesting would be the best?
Okay, so well, first, I don't know why they rejected the heliport plan, the option in 1996, because in 1996 I thought that was the most reasonable solution. But I think one argument might have been that in the future, the Marines would deploy the Ospreys, and then they might need the runway. But if you think about the whole purpose of the Ospreys is that you can do the vertical takeoff and landing. And I asked the people in Ginowon City who observed all the takeoffs and landings of the Ospreys from Futenma, and I asked them, was there a single time that you've seen an Osprey take off like an airplane? And they said no. But, you know, granted, during a military contingency when these Ospreys are fully loaded with combat equipment and ground forces, it might be better to take off horizontally. So I think the Marine Corps pushed back on the heliport idea and asked for some kind of runway. Now, I know why they rejected Kadena, because they were afraid that moving things to Kadena would then put greater pressure on Kadena and might jeopardize our ability to stay at Kadena. So they, at the end of the day, they settled on a kind of an airstrip that would be on pontoons out on the water, and this is what Prime Minister Hashimoto wanted. And there were a number of Japanese steel companies that thought this was great. The shipbuilding and steel companies were in recession, and this was a great project to get new business. And so that was one of the reasons why they settled on that. But then when they were finally thinking about going with this project under the Koizumi administration, there were demonstrators against that facility on boats, and Prime Minister Koizumi freaked out. And then Mr. Moria, who was, I think at the time, the Vice Minister of Defense, said, well, let's rethink this. And Rumsfeld was wondering, Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld was wondering why FDEMA was still open. And so then the two sides got to work, and the landfill facility got pushed. But it so happened that the landfill facility would favor local construction interests on Okinawa. So there was real interest group politics. Now, when Governor Nakajima became governor, you know, there was opposition to this landfill because it was so close in and it would cause more noise. And so the governor wanted to push it out a little bit. But because the deal had already been struck, even though the U.S. government negotiated against the Japanese because the U.S. government wanted it further out to sea as well, after the deal was sealed, then even the U.S. government said, let's not touch it. That's why we have what we have. Now, there was one other plan, which is the plan that Governor Inamine, who was Governor Nakajima's predecessor, he wanted a joint civilian-military facility out there that would be kind of offshore. And he agreed to this as long as there was a 15-year use limit. So after 15 years, the U.S. military would leave, and then this would become a civilian use facility. Well, the United States was not going to agree to a 15-year use limit. So that never moved forward. So there have been a number of versions that have been adopted, a lot for these interest group reasons, but it's still a mystery to me why the 1996, one of the three options of the heliport was abandoned. And this is why, you know, we want to revive it.
Makoto Honjo, associate. You mentioned the Kadena issue. Was inter-service rivalry an issue there? That's one. And what is your assessment about Okinawan independence movement going increasing in the event of a push from the Abe government on this this issue? And I think you mentioned in your paper about the Shimoji, a very right. fleeting reference to Shimoji right. sort of airport. And why is Shimoji not a option?
Right. Okay, first, in terms of Kadena and inter-service rivalry, that was certainly one factor that played in the rejection of the Kadena option. And then when the DPJ came into power, I believe it was Foreign Minister Okada that talked about the Kadena option as well. And yes, the U.S. Air Force did not seem too welcoming of the Marine Corps coming in. And the argument that I heard was that it would be dangerous to have fixed-wing aircraft and rotary-wing aircraft using the same air facility. But if you go to Kadena, it's a huge facility, and I can imagine there are places where you could have put helicopters. And if you look at the deployments that are occurring at the Anderson Air Force Base in Guam, you will have both fixed wing and rotary wing aircraft. So although that was the argument that was made for rejecting the Kadena plan, I don't think that necessarily is as compelling as they would say. But there is the other reason, which I mentioned, is that if we close down FDEMA without another facility on Okinawa, this would be the slippery slope. And the anti-base movement would turn on Kadena, especially if U.S. Marine Corps units would go to Kadena. And I've spoken to some of the leaders around Kadena, and you know, they're not satisfied with the way certain understandings between the Japanese government and the U.S. government have been implemented, that there's just still too much intrusive military activity around Kadena, especially at night. And so if you then add the Marines on there without reducing the Air Force presence in Kadena, then you could have a real problem around Kadena. So I think that's why the Kadena option did not fly. And you know, this is where Professor Hashimoto really gave a very important input into this project, is that, you know, as he said, not to think about this as a real estate transaction, that you know, you see FTEMA, you got to move FTEMA somewhere. And if you want to move FTEMA to Kadena, there's going to be a great deal of resistance. But it's more about redistributing the functions of FTEMA. And we believe that the some of the functions of FTEMA can be moved elsewhere, off of Japan, but also off of Okinawa to some of the main islands of Okinawa. Now, Shimoji Island, you know, that's always a possible option that's been considered. And, you know, there may be some local resistance to that. It goes against this notion that we need some kind of big military air facility for the Marine Corps on Okinawa. So although there is an airfield there, we think that that could be held in reserve, for example, during a Senkaku contingency. So, you know, we could have the Marines plus the new Japanese amphibious type of units do exercises near Shimojishima, and then if there is a real crisis over the Senkakus, if we had equipment pre-positioned in Shimoji, then a U.S. Marine Corps Marine Expeditionary Unit could fly there to signal to the Chinese not to mess with the Senkakus. But you know, ultimately, why we didn't push this is that we don't feel that it's necessary to have this full-scale base in Okinawa. Oh, Okinawa independence. Well, you know, maybe Professor Hashimoto might want to say something. But you know, just quickly on this, there's this change in public discourse and this feeling of discrimination, and kind of, you know, there is a slight movement towards independence, but I think it's still very modest. I don't know how it would be if this Henoko facility gets built, despite the resistance that might grow. But you know, there are all sorts of obstacles to independence, and we see this in Scotland and in elsewhere. You know, what has changed dramatically is that, you know, before the reversion of Okinawa to Japan, there was a debate in Okinawa about whether to return to Japan or not. And at the end of the day, the Okinawans thought it's better to return to Japan because Japan will take care of Okinawa and would help to reduce the military presence. And you know, over 40 years later, that has not happened. And that's why you're having, you know, you know, some major influential people in Okinawa saying, well, maybe we should begin to rethink that. But whether that becomes into a concrete independence movement, I mean, I think it's still too early to tell. Professor Hashimoto, do you want to add anything about independence?
So I know slightly 7 or 8% of Okinawan people agree with the independence of Okinawa, but now these anti-movement for against central government in Okinawa gradually increasing. So you know, today, so this problem, this issue has carried strongly into the court. So I suppose these struggle against central government are increasing gradually increasing, not decreasing. So if Okinawan's people Okinawan people want the independence of Okinawan, Ryukyu, but almost majority against, opposed to that independence of Okinawa. Before that, I'm very afraid. So so many people in Okinawa turning their opinion into the cardinal, against the cardinal movement. So as I said today, you know, so Kaduna Airport is a very pivotal airspace in the Asian. So that's United States are very concerned about that. Even if independence of Okinawa has succeeded, but before that, United States, I do expect United States has very concerned about the cardinal movement, cardinal movement. So that's why I have the opinion independence of Okinawa is impossible. Impossible, yeah.
If I can just add one point, the real worrying thing is that if there is a terrible incident comparable to what happened in fall 1995, or a crash of a Osprey in a residential area, or you know, imagine a school, a nursery facility. I mean, there was a wake-up call in 2004 when a helicopter crashed into the campus of Okinawa International University. I mean, it was the ideal wake-up call because no one was hurt. But in the context of this growing tension between Japan and Okinawa over this Henoko base, which we think, even if things move forward, it will take at least 10 years, if not more, to complete. During that time frame, and the probability is high that something will happen, then I don't know what kind of explosion in terms of public outcry we will see in Okinawa. And you know, I agree with Professor Hashimoto that independence is impossible to think about today. But in that context, I can imagine that the pro-independence forces might have some traction in Okinawan politics.
Well, okay, I think I'm going to take advantage of being a moderator and would like to ask a question. I have a feeling that this kind of opposition by the ordinary people as a whole prefecture against the central government is for the first time. It's totally unusual. And I think the worst thing that could happen to the Japanese-American alliance, and particularly from the point of view of the United States government, is a local opposition to the American bases. And I think it's been 70 years since the end of the war. And of course, we have been defeated and occupied. But over 104 military bases and facilities in the Japanese archipelago, which is smaller than the state of California, itself is unusual. It's the only country that's homeporting the U.S. aircraft carrier that's been rejected by Greece and England a long time ago. And I think it would be terrible for the United States and Japan as well to lose our alliance vis-a-vis the growing new world power. But the opposition of the ordinary people against the U.S. base is something that American people start seriously thinking of reducing it drastically, desirably. And that's not going to let Japan go anywhere. And I think this is coming for the first time. It's not by the radical group of students who are against the U.S. base. It's not because of the Chinese threat. It's the ordinary people. And the Okinawans can now live without American base revenue. They are, you know, inundated with a lot of tourists, and that situation is going to continue. So I think you mentioned Professor Nye and Deputy Secretary of Defense Amakost, Armitage, and Ambassador Amakost. Those are the so-called Japan...
Shinichihara.
Right. Yeah. Seriously saying these things should be taken seriously on the American side, taking example of this particular case and start reducing major plan, I think is a very, very important situation. This could not last for 10 years, in my view.
Well, on the anti-based issue, I mean, I know there are a number of other communities besides Okinawa that host bases, especially Kanagawa Prefecture, but, you know, near Misawa. You know, Iwakuni is out in the western part of Japan. And, you know, perhaps many of the local communities would rather not see those bases. But... I don't think that the intensity and the breadth of the movements in those communities can compare with that of Okinawa. So the U.S. government and the Japanese government, as I said, since the 1950s has been very sensitive to that and has really scaled down the U.S. military presence, so that I think we're at an equilibrium, although it's an uneasy equilibrium. And the realignment has addressed even more of this situation. For example, we're moving the carrier aircraft from Atsugi to Iwakuni. And one of the reasons is that the training before the carriers deploy is very kind of intrusive to the local community. And so we're sensitive to that. But with Okinawa, you know, it just seems that, you know, 74% of the U.S. That the bases that are only for U.S. use still remain in Okinawa and a large part of the land area, and so it's that fundamental inequality. And then there's this disconnect between the local community that says not in my backyard. And the security policies community, which, you know, states what you've just said, sir, that don't leave us. You know, we want you to stay. And so it's that fundamental contradiction that needs to be addressed. And so we feel that there is a new equilibrium that could be found, that we reduce our footprint without weakening deterrence, taking advantage of technological innovations, but also being aware that the security challenges have changed, and then at the same time reducing the burden. You know, ultimately, it would be great if we saw a world where these kinds of U.S. military bases were unnecessary. You know, unfortunately, we seem to be going in the opposite direction, and so I'm very much for much more creative diplomacy to promote cooperative security. But in the meantime, you know, the reality is that we need some kind of U.S. military presence. And if we aren't sensitive to these anti-base movements, then, you know, as I said, this is the Achilles heel of the U.S.-Japan alliance. And, you know, if China wants to drive a wedge between the United States and Japan, I mean, I cannot think of a better issue than the Okinawa base. Issue.
Any other questions? Now open to the floor. Yes, please.
My name is Howard Yu. I'm a reciprocal member. I grew up in Okinawa, and often as a child in the 1960s and 70s, I would go into Fudema Base. And it's known as a dead base, I think, even till today. There's nothing pretty much happening on the base. I think the most activity is the basketball court with all the kids going to play basketball. But I'd like to ask a question to you. If this was in a situation in Hawaii, and they're going to build a new military facility offshore, or landfill. And it seems to me it's quite hypocritical that in the U.S. it could never happen with all the environmentalists and all that. But in Japan, there seems it's a silent, you know. It's allowed in Japan. But if this was in the case of the U.S., what is your opinion on if this could be developed if it's in the U.S. state?
A landfill facility in Hawaii or?
Yes, a military facility, a landfill, similar to what Henoku is being proposed. Could that be built in Hawaii, and what would the opposition be in the U.S.?
Right. Well, first of all, you know, we already have plenty of facilities on Hawaii, and as part of the realignment plan, U.S. Marine Corps units are going to Hawaii. So it's not as if we need a new base in Hawaii in order to replace the one in Futenma or as an alternative to the Henoku. And I think, you know, the irony is that many of the local communities in the United States have appealed to their members of Congress not to close bases during the whole base closing program. And so Michael O'Hanlon and I have argued that, you know, it just might make sense to bring back the bulk of the Marine Corps from Okinawa, going all the way to Camp Pendleton. So, you know, that was kind of the starting point of our analysis, and we showed militarily how that can be done without weakening deterrence and our crisis response through pre-positioning. And so this is why the proposal that we put forward here is a compromise proposal. That, you know, we understand the reality. You know, we're already invested in Guam, you know, some Japanese want us to stay, and so why not stay in a much more modest way? And then if we had a joint U.S.-Japan facility on the main islands, you know, that could eventually be taken over by the Japanese, and, you know, this would be a good thing. You know, I think the reason why we have this unhealthy situation in the U.S.-Japan alliance is that, you know, there's a lot of anti-military pacifist sentiment in Japan, but on the other hand, Japan has chosen to rely upon the United States for its security. And so we have this contradiction. But I think as Japan, you know, moves, you know, very incrementally to taking more of the responsibility for its own defense, then it is possible to reduce the U.S. footprint in Japan.
Any other questions? Yes, please.
My name is Okumura, as I introduced myself earlier. And I'm a management consultant on global business. Then I am more practical about those things than, you know, academic, like you gentlemen. And from my analysis, I don't think Futenma will be closed in a foreseeable future for a variety of reasons. But suppose it does close, then what's going to happen afterwards? In other words, who is going to, or what's going to happen to the evacuated land, its space? I understand that the U.S. force used the store nuclear weapon there, atomic bomb, and also they still have chemical weapons like saline, those things. Who's going to, you know, clean them up, then turn the place to a Sarachi? That's number one. And what's going to happen to the people? I understand they've got about 1,000 employees working there. And who is going to then if Futenma is closed, they will be out of job. Who's going to take care of those people? That, for the time being, my questions are those two. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I would just have to give my rebuttal to the notion that somehow our proposal is not practical, because I think it's eminently practical. We're very pragmatic, and if you were to do a simple cost analysis of this, it's far cheaper to implement our plan than to spend the billions of dollars building the landfill facility. We're also quite aware of the problem of the cleanup of Futenma. You know, there have been some a number of creative plans that Okinawans have developed for what to do with Futenma once it's returned. And I hope eventually we see the day when some of these plans could be realized. But you're absolutely right that in any of these facilities that would be returned, there will be major cleanup. And this is why I think the local community has been pushing for a revision of the Status of Forces Agreement, especially regarding environmental inspections. And so the quicker that that could be implemented, then we would know the extent of the task ahead. If you read our proposal, this is eminently pragmatic because we see a transitional period in which the operations, the dangerous operations around Futenma, although it may be a dead base, there are still activity around there, that those would come to an end. But Futenma would remain as a reserve facility until the second runway at Naha Airport would be built, and the United States and Japan would really implement the U.S.-Japan Defense Cooperation Guidelines so that the U.S. military feels confident that during a military contingency, which we all hope will never have to happen, that the United States would have emergency access to those facilities. So during that interim period, your 1,000 employees, I'm sure, could find things to do to maintain their jobs. But this argument about employment has often been misused. The argument that even Secretary of State Condi Rice used this when she came to Japan. Oh, that aren't the bases necessary for the economy? Don't they provide jobs? And certainly to an extent that has been the case. But if you are thinking about the future development of Okinawa, to be so concerned about the existing jobs, the 1,000 jobs, which I think could continue, and not acknowledge the obstacles that the bases prevent for long-term development of Okinawa, then it's an absolute misreading of the political economy of Okinawa. I mean, anyone who goes to Okinawa and drives down the national road there sees how congested it is. If you go right by Camp Kinzer and Maki Minato, which is prime real estate for good ecological commercial development, and it's just sitting there as a storage area, that the notion that the U.S. bases are necessary for the Okinawan economy just does not hold water. Yes, the cleanup is important. I'm sure that the United States and Japan can find a way to figure out how who will pay for the cleanup. I think a lot of it will be paid for by Japan, but we have to know what's there. But this will take time. But in the meantime, the most important thing is to close down the operations of Futenma so that another accident does not take place. That's the most urgent thing.
think it's just about time now. And so we will close for now. But before we close, representing the club, I would like to give you, for our token of present, membership, honorary membership for 1 year. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much
for the wonderful time. Thank you, everyone.